Hello everyone, I am Dimple Rangila and today we will talk about approaches of teaching in a classroom. So the first approach that we are going to talk about is teaching for behavior modification. We have learned that learning is a relatively permanent change in behavior. Behavior means different for different persons. The behavior modification approach to teaching is based on the belief that when we change or modify the observable behavior of a child, we are directly or indirectly trying to help the child to learn. The behaviors that are observable are mainly of two types, elicited behavior and emitted behavior. So, learning by behavior modification, we move on further. There are two phases of behavior modification. Making sure that the elicited or the emitted behaviors occur again and again as and when required. And secondly, to continue the process of modification to refine the existing and acquired behaviors to acquire more and more new behaviors. The process of habituating the child, or for that matter, any organism, human being, or even an animal, to repeat and modify both the types of behaviors is called conditioning by psychologists. There are two major types of conditioning depending on the two types of behaviors. First one of these is classical conditioning, that is conditioning of elicited behavior, and operant conditioning for conditioning the emitted behaviors. So first we'll talk about classical conditioning by Ivan Pavlov. So Pavlov did an experimental study wherein he kept a dog hungry for a few days and then tied it to the experimental table, which was fitted with certain mechanically controlled devices. The observer himself remained hidden from the dog but was able to see through a set of one-way mirrors. He also arranged for a bell to ring every time food was presented to the dog. When the food was put before the dog and the bell rung, there was an automatic salivation by dog. After several trials, the dog was given no food but the bell was only rung. So here in this figure you can see the experimental setup where there is a dog, there is an observation one-way screen, a tube for collection of saliva, the container of meat powder that was served to the dog, device to count the drops of saliva, and there is a revolving drum for recording the response. So the experimental observation, it was found that even in the absence of food, which was the natural stimulus, the ringing of the bell, which was the artificial stimulus, caused the dog to secrete the saliva, which was a natural response. So there were four elements that we talked about. Pavlov called the food as the unconditioned stimulus. The response to it, which was the saliva of the dog, was the unconditioned response. The bell that was rung, that was called the artificial or the conditioned stimulus, and now the saliva was the conditioned response because the dog was salivating even after listening only to the bell and even before the food was served to the dog. So here you can see that before conditioning, when the food was there, seeing the food, which was the unconditioned stimulus, the dog gave the response by salivating, which was the unconditioned response. Then a bell or a whistle was introduced, which was a neutral stimulus that led to no salivation, so no unconditioned response. During condition, after every time the bell was rung or the whistle was blown, then the food was served. So the dog responded by salivating. This he called as the unconditioned response. And after the dog got conditioned to this, only the ringing of the bell or the whistle, which was a conditioned stimulus now, led to a conditioned response of salivation by the dog. Now, the second type of conditioning, as we talked about, B.F. Skinner was the main proponent of operant conditioning. Operant conditioning, thus, is the outcome of a series of elaboratory designed experiments by B.F. Skinner in 1940s with rats and pigeons. In general terms, operant conditioning is to strengthen or to reinforce the behavior emitted by an organism so that the probability of its occurrence increases. This increase is the result of reinforcement. So, the occurrence of the emitted behavior and also the shaping behavior by modification of emitted behavior can be possible by bringing in lot of variations in the schedule of reinforcement. Reinforcement always strengthens the occurrence of the emitted behavior. However, there are two types of reinforcements. Let's see the positive and the negative reinforcement. Positive reinforcement or reward involves the presentation of a pleasant stimulus followed by an emitted behavior which strengthens the occurrence of the behavior. So, any behavior that we want to be repeated again, we use a positive reinforcement. For example, whenever a teacher smiles at the students, says something pleasant to them, praises them for their work, assigns them good or high grades, he or she is using positive reinforcement. Negative reinforcement occurs when removal of an aversive or unpleasant stimulus following an emitted behavior strengthens the occurrence of the behavior. Threats of punishment, failure, detention, humiliation, ridicule, and several others are examples of aversive stimuli given by teachers in classroom, which, when removed, provide relief to the students followed by the occurrence of the desired behaviors which the students emit. The teacher has to realize that punishment is not reinforcement. Punishment is inflicted either by presenting a painful stimulus or by removing a pleasant stimulus, which invariably cause a lot of hurt and painful feelings, both physically and emotionally, to students. So, we talked about the positive reinforcement. That is making a behavior stronger by following the behavior with a pleasant stimulus. Negative reinforcement, making a behavior stronger by taking away a negative stimulus. Punishment, the negative punishment is reducing a behavior by removing a pleasant stimulus. Positive punishment, reducing a behavior by presenting an unpleasant stimulus. So in this case, as we can see, the Skinner box or the operant box as it is called, there is a rat, and by pressing the right liver, the rat will be delivered a food pellet, or the rat will get an electric shock. So rats were placed in these metal cages with a number of levers. At first, the rat would nose around the cage and by chance or accidentally press the lever, an action that would cause food or water to drop into a dish. After repeating the action, the rat saw that they could receive food and water by pressing a particular lever. So they, in a way, learned this behavior. So when the rats were rewarded, they were conditioned to repeat the positive action to continue being rewarded. So a rat presses a lever and receives food. This is positive reinforcement. And a rat presses a lever and turns off the electric shock. That is a negative reinforcement. Similarly, a positive punishment, if the rat previously pressed the lever and received food and now receives a shock, the rat will learn not to press that lever. Negative punishment, if rat now receives food consistently without pressing the lever, the rat will learn to stop pressing that particular lever. Now we'll see the relevance of behavior modification approach in the classroom. Repetition is very important for learning. So the more the children are made to practice, the more they will learn. Repetition without reinforcement does not enhance learning. So, teacher has to reinforce the child along with making them repeat a thing, a particular topic or an area. So, this reinforcement is by praising the child. Variations in presenting the reinforcers also helps in modification of behavior. So, not every time a similar kind of reinforcer works. A teacher has to have a number of reinforcers to reinforce the child's behavior. Punishment is not effective, as we talked earlier also, for eliminating undesirable behavior. Interest in work and in improvement is always conducive to learning and will promote learning in children. The criticisms of behavior modification approach. First criticism is that it only considers the observable behaviors for modification and hence for learning. So all those behaviors which are not observable cannot be studied through or cannot be impacted through behavior modification approach. It might be quite suitable for animals and for very young children, but as children advance in their ages, there is mental development and the observable behavior may not reflect the actual intention of the child, because as they grow older, they also learn how they can behave in a particular way but may feel or intend to do something else. A school-age child demonstrates some behaviors only to attract the attention of others and to avoid punishment. Sometimes, children also do certain kinds of behavior just to gather attention of the other person. Hence, any modification of manifest behavior may not actually result in learning. So, not all behavior modification will lead to a learning behavior. So, that was the first part of it. Now, we come to teaching for development of cognition. Now, the dictionary meaning of cognition is the art of knowing. Usually, it is concerned with knowing, understanding, processing, and using information, and these are considered as mental abilities or components of intelligence. To cognize means to know. Even activities like remembering, problem solving comes under cognition. Cognitive development refers to the stages and processes involved in child's intellectual development. Your Piaget consists of cognitive development as consisting of a series of stages that he calls as universal and also sequential in that take place in a particular sequence, each characterized by certain kinds of behaviors and certain ways of thinking and solving problems. All the 8 specific stages that have been grouped are these 4 broad stages that he talked about. From birth to 2 years of age is the sensory motor development stage. 2 to 7 years is the pre-operational stage. 7 to 11 or 12 years is the concrete operational stage. And 11 to 12 years to 14 to 15 years is the formal operation stage. So this is a diagrammatic representation of the stages of Piaget's cognitive development, wherein in the sensory motor stage, birth to 2 years, he talked about the infant learning about the environment through his or her motor and the sensory abilities. So, the sensory abilities are the sense of touch, hearing, tasting, smelling. Through these and the motor activities, as the child is growing older, they learn about the environment around them. We'll talk about these stages in detail. The pre-operational stage, now the child uses symbols to represent objects but does not reason logically. The child also has the ability to pretend. During this stage, the child is also egocentric. Egocentrism means that the child is not able to view the perspective of the other person. So, the child only considers his or her own perspective about a particular thing. For example, if a child is talking to his or her parent over the phone, at the same time the child is nodding his or her head as if the parent can also see that particular behavior or see that nodding of the head. Or if the child is in watching television and the mother is in the kitchen and the child tries to show something that is coming on the television without realizing that the parent is in the other room and cannot see that visual. So, but gradually children overcome this kind of egocentric behavior. Then the concrete operational stage, the child can think logically about concrete objects and can thus add and subtract. The child also understands conservation. Conservation is the ability to understand that certain things remain the same even if the outer characteristics change. We'll talk about conservation in the coming slides in detail. Formal operational stage, from 12 years onwards, the adolescent can reason abstractly and can think of problems in hypothetical terms. We'll talk about this also in detail in the coming slide. So, the major trends of cognitive development. During the first 2 years of life, the child performs activities mostly driven by the sense organs that I told you and their motor activities, that is movement of the muscles of the body, which can be the fine motor or the gross motor activities, that is the movement of the fine muscles or the larger muscles. For an infant at this stage, objects exist when they can be seen, heard, touched, tasted or smelled, and when they are removed from the infant's immediate sensory experience, they cease to exist. So that is what I talked about, object permanence. So what is out of sight is out of mind for them. So something that does not exist in front of them, if you remove something in front of them, they stop thinking about it. But gradually, as they grow a little more older, you put something in front of them and remove that, the child will look in the direction where you are trying to hide that object. So, they overcome the object permanence also very soon. Towards the end of this sensory motor period, the child can identify the objects around him or her and can imitate several actions of others. And at a later stage, the child can imitate the actions even in the absence of those things or objects, which is called as deferred imitation. So imitation would be if somebody is waving a hand towards the child and the child also imitates a similar kind of behavior. Whereas deferred imitation would be if we ask a child what is the sound of a train and the child takes out that particular sound. So that thing which is not there in the presence of the child at that time and the child is able to imitate about a person or an object, that time it is called as a deferred imitation of a particular thing. This indicates that the child can observe the actions minutely, internalizes those actions and reproduce it, signifying the early form of intentional action, which are a part of intelligent activity on the part of the child. Piaget defined operations as mental activities subject to certain rules of logic. According to him, operations in true form do not appear before the age of 7, but with development of language ability, the child tries to reason out in a crude way during the pre-operational period or the second stage of the cognitive development. It is during the concrete operation period, that is from 7 to 11 or 12 years of age, children make a fundamentally important transition from a pre-logical form of thought to logical thinking that apply to real concrete objects and events. Three important mental abilities that develop during this period with manipulation of concrete objects and events. They are conservation, classification and seriation. Let's take up all these three. Conservation is the realization that quantity or amount does not change when nothing has been added to or taken away from an object or a collection of objects. Despite changes in form or arrangement in space, conservation of number, volume, mass, length comes only in concrete operational stage, whereas a child in a pre-operational stage cannot do conservation. So in the first diagram that you can see, conservation of number, you can see the coins are placed together and the child is asked to count the number of coins in the two rows. Then after the child responds, coins in one of the rows is spread and then the child is asked which row has more number of coins. So Piaget found that children in the pre-operational stage felt that the coins in the row which is spread out are more in number. So they could not do conservation of number as compared to a child in the concrete operational stage. Similarly, conservation of mass. If there is a clay ball, two clay balls of equal sizes are shown to a child and then one of these balls is rolled out and then the child is asked which one has the more mass. So a child who is in the concrete operational stage would go back to the previous stage and would be able to say that initially they were the same. So that means both have the equal mass. Conservation of liquid. If we show two beakers, exactly similar beakers with equal quantity of water, and the child is asked which glass has more water, and let's say that your child says that the both glasses have equal quantity of water, then in front of the child only we transfer liquid from one of the glasses to a flat bowl, and then the child is asked which of the two containers now has more quantity of liquid. So children in the pre-operational stage will look at the height of the container and will not look at the depth of the other, width of the other container, and might say that the beaker, that the container that is longer has more liquid, whereas the concrete operational stage child who has attained conservation will say that they are from the same beakers, so the amount of, they will go back to the previous step, which is also called as reversibility, and would be able to say that both the beakers have equal amount of liquid in them. Next is classification. Classification is to group objects according to their similarities and differences. Classification involves comparing and contrasting the objects on different characteristics like size, shape, color, weight, use, material, etc. A child in a pre-operational stage is not capable of classifying objects and cannot compare more than two objects at a time. For example, if we give children red colored squared blocks, red colored rectangular blocks, green colored square blocks, green colored rectangular blocks, and we ask them to classify. So they will be able to only do classification as per at 1 to 2 different classification criteria, whereas a child in the concrete operational stage would be able to go in a sequential manner and would be able to classify the object as per size, shape and multiple variations. Seriation is the ability to arrange similar objects in a definite order, either in the increasing or the decreasing order. So a concrete operational child becomes better at seriating objects if we give it to them to arrange in an increasing or in a decreasing order. The child will go in a step-by-step sequence, will either pick out the biggest or the smallest of the object. Beside these three, the ability to deal with numbers, a direct product of classification and seriation, develops during the stage of concrete operations. The last, the formal operation stage, which is the final stage of cognitive development, it is formal because the subject matters with which children can now deal are mostly imaginary or hypothetical, or as we call as abstract, and free from any concrete objects that we offer to the children and or events. The thinking process at this stage involves propositional reasoning. For example, if we ask the child if A is greater than B and B is greater than C, then what is the relationship between A and C? So such problems involving abstract and propositional logic can be solved by children in concrete, and even formal operations children will be able to solve the even complex operations than these. They will also be able to do hypothetical deductive reasoning, wherein they, if we pose a particular problem in front of them, they will first think of all the possible solutions to that particular problem and then deduce the best possible alternative by weighing pros and cons of all the solutions that they could have adopted and give a final answer or a solution to the problem that has been posed in front of the child. So after Piaget's theory, another theory is by Vygotsky, Lev Vygotsky, who was a famous Russian psychologist, and he stresses the impact of culture and language on cognitive development. With intensive interaction with the elements of culture and a healthy language development, we become capable of higher mental functions which are involved in thinking, reasoning, remembering and so on. Further, Vygotsky states that a child progresses through these stages in developing the language functions. So first he called as the social or the external speech, that around 3 to 4 years, when that children use largely to control others or to express this simple concept. Egocentric speech, 3 to 7 years, he talked about, is mostly talking about self and is usually spoken out aloud that others can listen. It has a role in controlling and directing the child's own behavior. The inner speech that he talked about, that comes around 7 years of age, is marked by unspoken verbalizations that control the thought and behavior that the other person cannot hear. We speak, we talk to ourselves and it's not audible to others. Vygotsky argues strongly for language related activities in schools and inclusion of these kind of cultural elements in the curricular interaction within as well as the outside the school. So considering the children in primary schools, most of them are in the concrete operation, while those in the upper primary school are in the formal operation period. As discussed, these two periods, especially the concrete operation stage, is very crucial for cognitive development. Therefore, as teachers, you need to develop your teaching strategies for development of cognition of children by bringing in these mix of concepts. So this shows the idea of zone of proximal development that Vygotsky developed. So the inner orange circle that you can see is the current development of the child. And according to Vygotsky, if there are other people in the child's vicinity who can be teachers, who can be peers, who can be parents, they can bring the child beyond their current potential of theirs, and they can maximize the potential by just being facilitators and guide to the child and the potential development, as you can see in the yellow circle. So they can be the ones who can take the child from that one circle much beyond that their own current level of development, and this area, this zone he called as the zone of proximal development, and he really considered the importance of teachers, parents and other peers who can help the children actualize and maximize the potential that they have. So the teachers need to strike an optimal balance, which Piaget called as equilibration. So everyone wants to be in a balance and equilibration stage, as Piaget said, between using previous experiences, old learning and behavior, he called as assimilation, and making new changes as accommodation. So Piaget said that there is a need for striking a balance between, so whenever we have an existing information about a particular concept, we have assimilated that, but as soon as we realize that there is something new that does not match with our existing criteria, we try to learn and that new concept. In that way, we are accommodating. So when we are assimilated everything, we are in a state of equilibrium or a state of balance. But as soon as we realize that our current existing structures are not matching with the new information that we are getting, we feel a state of disequilibrium. So according to Piaget, we want to remain in the state of balance. So at that time, we accommodate to learn, that gain that new knowledge, and to create a balance or as equilibration that helps the child in adapting the change in behavior and action. While providing learning experiences, maturation levels of the children have to also be recognized. Maturation unfolds the hereditary characteristics, which helps us to make appropriate learning provisions. You cannot ask a child to sing a song loudly when she has not developed full control over her speech producing organs, which develops according to a particular course of action. Cognitive development depends directly on the child's day-to-day activities and experiences with real objects and events. So the teacher needs to provide these kinds of experiences to the children. Provision should be made for a relatively large amount of activities, both physical, mental, relating to learning to real objects and events, especially before the children go into the formal operation stage. Social interaction, that is interaction with others, is fundamental to development of notions about others, about things around us, and about the self. Such interactions, predominantly verbal in nature, help in development of language abilities and understanding relations, both of which are crucial for cognitive development. So Vygotsky gave a lot of importance to social interaction as well. Understanding children is important on the part of teacher. It's very important that the teacher understands the child, and if a child is saying a particular thing or has behaved in a particular way, the teacher needs to understand from the child's perspective that why, what made the child do so. Language is the primary symbolic expression of our thought. Therefore, giving children more chance to speak freely is not only helping to develop his or her cognition, but also to understand the child better through his or her expressions. So, giving them a lot of opportunities to express themselves freely is something that is required. The third is teaching for construction of experience. A student constructs his or her knowledge on the basis of interaction with his or her environment. The following two assumptions are basis of constructivist learning. Knowledge is actively constructed by the student, not passively received from the environment. So we should consider the child as an active being, one who has their own opinions, who can act upon the environment, and are not just a passive being or empty slates on which we can write, or empty vessels that we fill up, because they also innately acquire certain characteristics, and they can also make an impact on the environment as the environment can impact them. Coming to know is a process of adaptation based on and constantly modified by students' experience of the world. Put simply, the experience of a student is more important in learning new things. He or she can modify his or her previous experience in order to solve a problematic situation and thereby constructing new experience or acquiring new knowledge. But how does the process of construction of knowledge takes place? Let's look at this. The construction of knowledge takes place in the following ways. Connecting new ideas with the previous knowledge or experience helps in constructing new knowledge. So the child has a concept of a particular thing, and then we add on to a new concept. So their previous knowledge is very important. That's why there is an importance of revising, recapitulating the previous knowledge that the child has and making the child recall. Focusing on the interrelationships among concepts, new ideas or knowledge is constructed. If we can establish connections of similarity and dissimilarity among related concepts, learning new things becomes much easier and more meaningful, because the child can either relate to the similarity between the two concepts or how the two things are dissimilar. Forming mental images both at the initial stage of learning and mental representations of interrelationships is the key process in construction of knowledge. So when they form mental images of certain things and the interrelationships of the concepts that we are trying to make them understand, it's become more engaging and more meaningful. Interacting in social groups or on social themes helps to make learning more meaningful and engaging. Social interaction makes the students realize the different real world problems. He or she during that may ask questions, respond to others, reflect on the problem, gains multiple interpretations of the problem, what are the perspective and viewpoints of other children, and finally has an overall mental representation of the problem which he or she tries to solve mentally. As a result of the mental representations of the different aspects of the problem, solution emerges, signifying new construction of knowledge. Let's look at the role of the teacher. Facilitating students in their efforts to learn without directly instructing them on any new concepts. So the teacher as a guide or as a facilitator is very important. Being sensitive to the previous experiences, we have talked about this previously as well, so that it can be related of each and every student in the class. Providing authentic tasks with the experiences which are from the real world, and as we talked about, these have to be contextual and based on a particular situation that is relevant to the context that the child is in. Providing as many materials and experiences from the immediate environment as possible. Manipulating materials and events so that the students can gather more experiences. Providing real world context based learning environments rather than predetermined instructional sequences for making learning more realistic, relevant and contextual, because then the learning becomes more meaningful. The child is actively engaged in the processes and activities that we are doing. The child has an active agency, the child has a voice, and thus the child can go through all the steps of a particular situation that we want the child to go through. Or if they are not doing an individual activity, they are doing a group activity, then also the whole group, it leads to collaboration, peer learning, peer tutoring. They talk to each other and discuss collectively as to how to solve a particular problem. Focusing on realistic approaches to solve real world problems, providing or and encouraging the students to come out with multiple representations or alternative solutions when engaged in solving a problem. This can also be done by, if for example, if we give a story to we narrate a story and we did not tell them the ending of the story, and we make the children guess how would the story end. So every child will have a different interpretation of the same. Allowing students to ask questions, encouraging them to raise intelligent questions, and even if a question is not very intelligent question, then also the very fact that the child is able to ask you questions and has been able to think about those questions is the first step to raising intelligent questions later on. Fostering reflective practice, encourage children to only raise intelligent questions. It indirectly puts pressure on the child to think reflectively. Supporting cooperative and collaborative learning, as I said, that if it's a group activity, then children will be involved in give and take, cooperation, sharing, collaborative learning, and they will also take the other child along with them while they are moving ahead in the particular task. Connecting the activities in the school with those outside the school. So this is also very important, that there should be a link between the activities that they are doing in the school and the activities that are outside of the school, because learning cannot be split that this concept is only relevant for school. There are the concepts they should be able to relate in real life situation also. There also they should be able to solve that particular problem. Encouraging self-analysis and self-assessment of their learning progress. So let them also think and reflect, introspect on how they have done a particular activity, how would it could have been done in a different way by self-assessment and self-analysis. So we talked about the changing role of a teacher who is an expert and a knowledge transmitter to a facilitator, coach and a contractor. These were the different ways that can be used in the classroom. So we talked about teaching for behavior modification by using behavior modification approach, teaching for development of cognition, and teaching by construction of experiences and knowledge construction. Thank you.